I mean, Skinner, it's SWN Podcast, I guess, if you want.
Welcome to the latest edition of SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And yes, even though I said I was not recording in May, I got a message in my inbox from someone, and I had to get them on the show as soon as possible. I am joined, if you're watching the video, you already know who it is, but I am joined by one of the most well-traveled wrestlers in the country right now that's operating within Scotland, currently out with an injury, so thankfully we'll be able to nab her. It is the mother of chaos. It's Kasey. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Hello, thank you for having me on, and sorry for ruining your plans for the month off. I'm so sorry, but
that's
mine got ruined as well.
Fine. That's absolutely fine. To be perfectly honest with you, my wife went to a music festival in Elgin, and I was on dad duties for like the last 3 days, so I'm quite happy to have an hour or two just because he's 9 months old, and you know what? I didn't think he was going to be a lot of work. He's a lot more work than I thought he was going to be, so... bit more respect for her than I had before, but yes, yeah. Injury, bit of a wrist injury.
Yeah, a little bit. It's when your wrist goes like this, and then you have to get this. No, it happened at the Iron Girders show. It was actually Hera's debut. God love her, and she hit a TKO, and. None of us know how it happened. None of us understands how my arm went. There's a very clear photo that David Wilson took. Me in the middle of the air, taking the move, and my arm's out here. How it got under her when we landed and her landing on it, we don't know. Like, the mechanics just are baffling, but it ended up in a what they call a dinner fork fracture. And when the nurse told me that, I looked at it, I was like, yeah, makes sense. Because it was like this way, and then this bit went down, like it would for a fork. And then the hand's like all like me. So I had to have surgery 4 days later on the 6th to put pins in it. If the surgeon wasn't happy with the pins, then he would have had to open my wrist and put a plate in. But luckily he was happy with the pins. So I've been in a lovely cast since the 2nd of April. And hopefully this Thursday, what date is it? 4th of May, they will be coming out. So when people are watching this, then they'll hopefully be out by then.
Fingers crossed. But no, as soon as I saw that, it's like I had a similar, well, it was my elbow, and they called it a terrible triad, is what they called it at the time, which got everyone quite excited because they'd never seen one like that before. And I thought, oh, great, that's fine. But it was like pretty much just 3 bones in your elbow, and I broke all of them.
Wow.
Which is pretty impressive.
That is pretty impressive.
But so when I saw your x-rays and saw the pictures you put up, the picture was like, yeah, I can feel, I can get that sympathy, and I know how that kind of feels just a little bit further up. And it's it was one of those, again, I was drunk. You were actually sober at the time. But I was drunk. I fell off one of those children's spinning discs. And
oh, no.
And that was it. That was all she wrote. I put my arm down to protect myself, and I was in hospital for a week. But anyway, part of the fun. I was far too old when people ask what age I was. But, you know, one of those things. But this isn't about me. This is about yourself. So usually when we have someone on, I was going through just trying to get some notes. And I've got a whole page of, like matches and opponents and little moments from each year, thinking, there's a lot that I want to try and touch upon. It might not get everything, might end up a part two somewhere down the line, but we'll go right back to the start. So according to Cage Match, which is always a scary proposition because it's never right usually. Your debut way back in 2010. What made you decide to pursue wrestling?
Well, that's the thing, like my professional debut was then. I'd done like sort of little like backyardy type shows. We hired a boxing ring and like we taught ourselves how to wrestle basically before that. But then my professional debut was after training with Machine. for a few months, and Steve Muldoon was running his Wrestling IE shows. So we were like, I'll do ring crew. I want to learn from as many people as possible. And he says, well, we can do a tag match. There you go. Have a go. It was kind of nerve-wracking because it was me and Machine versus Jordan Devlin, now JD Madonna, or whatever you call him, and Rachel Sinclair in Londonderry. So that was fun. And then that was just us from then on. It was me and Rachel for a good long time from then. But what got me into wrestling was pretty much just like watch it with my older brother and my dad. And then as we grew up and I got big enough, my brother was like, come here, let me try and suplex you. And the amount of sofas we broke and things like that, because we were choke slamming each other and all the rest of it, out in the back garden, hitting Twister Fates and stuff, like just having a laugh. And then I remember saying to mom when I was like 11 or 12, like, I'm going to be a professional wrestler. And she was like, yeah, okay, Kelly, that's, yeah, okay, get your education, please. So I did. I was the smart one. I went and got my degree and all like that out the way while I was doing my wrestling training, and then just focused on this ever since.
So we did an interview like way back when, right about the time my website started, it was like 2015 or something. We did like an OSW meets, and you're quite happy to, you're quite willing to do it. It was, to be honest, it's not my best work, but it was really right at the start. So it's like five questions and they're very basic. But I was going through just that to see if I could pick anything out from there. And you mentioned Twist of Fate. And of course, one of the influences you noted was Lita as well. So it was just Serios and Lita, I think, versus.
Yeah, Goldberg. With her debut.
So yeah, was it just as soon as Lita was appears, that was that the dream was.
It was just like I love seeing the girls on WWF and things like that. But it's just. I didn't see like Lita hitting that moonsault off the top. I was like, oh wow. And then doing her Lita Kanranas and all the rest of that. I was like, this looks like fun. I want to do this. And she was just like, I was the alternative kid at the time. And like mainly we were like the wee outcasts of our class and stuff like that. And that's where we found our home was watching wrestling. And we felt like this like kindred spirit sort of thing with Lita. So it was just like, yeah, Lita and Hardy Boys.
Best. That's best of all time. They're my favorites. Jeff Hart, you see the pops in the background and all
I
that.
Mean, the GOAT of all time is Mr. Guerrero, but I still haven't got Jeff's, the Hardy Boys shirt yet or Lita shirt yet, but I will get it. Wrestling Vintage, I will buy those.
Yeah, well, for Hardy Boys, I went one step further and I've got a tattoo, so it's just like, that was my first tattoo.
I nearly wore my Hardy Boys basketball jersey, and I was like, no, I need to pimp the Vintage shirts.
That's right. It looks so cool to see those things. I've got that many wrestling shirts as it is. I'm like, do I need more? And then I see yourself wearing them. I'm like, maybe I do need a couple more.
That's the thing, though. It started off like I got BT his, which ones did I get him first, actually? I got him Taker and I got him the Ultimate Warrior ones. And then for his birthday there, he got Stone Cold and Bam Bam. So he's going to start. I mean, he collects football shirts anyway. So I was like, perfect.
Amazing. So you mentioned like being outcasts and being wrestling fans. Did you ever find that when you were at school? I mean, there's always going to be like. I assume you're not too far off my age. I'm assuming younger, but right about my age anyway. Was there kind of a stigma to liking wrestling in school?
Oh yeah, and especially the fact that we were at an all girls school, and our file was cut, like our files were covered in like all the cutouts from wrestling magazines and like Kerrang magazine and stuff like that. So we were walking around like Cradle of Filth and stuff like that, all covered in blood all over our our files and our books and stuff like that. And people are going, okay. Funny fact, we weren't allowed to go to one of the assemblies in school because it was like an Easter assembly, and they were like, oh no, you're Satanists, like you're not allowed in, it's all about God and all this. So I was like, just because I'm wearing black? Like, really? Wow. Okay. Cool beans. Funny enough things. I am a Satanist now. So that's good old TST.
So they sensed it in you. They knew it. Did you ever have a break from watching wrestling, or was that it? Were you always just...
No, like, there was a time in my life where there was a bit of a break from it, but I was always drawn come back to it and always came back to it. And then it was really from, I want to say when I was about, like, between 13 and about 15, I didn't really see much. Like, I kept up to date with it, but I wasn't like, I have to watch every single pay-per-view, I have to watch every single Raw and SmackDown, all the rest of it. But yeah, there was a break, but I'm back. So it was just like, I can't leave it anymore.
It's also when you're that age, you're at the mercy of your parents and what they can provide as well. So it's like for me,
the amount of VHS tapes that we have that have no way out, whatever year, do not tape over, like, written on
the tab out, take the tab out. But that was the thing for me anyway, is that, yeah, right about that time, right about 2003-ish, I didn't see anything because I didn't have Sky, and it was on Sky One. So I would just get the dial-up going so I could see WWE.com and find out what's happening. Yeah. And you always had a friend who had Sky Box Office, and you could get the tapes off them. And
yeah, exactly.
But no, speaking of that, I think I've got like 40, 50 tapes of just taped off Sky. Because
yeah, they always find they weren't long enough for some of them. Like, some of them were, the main event was cut out halfway through because it stopped recording, and you're like,
"That's it." God bless my pal's dad, because he stayed up for two nights to record WrestleMania 17 because it ran out in the long play, so he had to stay up another night to record it on the replay to get the main event.
I mean, good on him. Good on him.
God bless that man. So you made your official debut then. So actually, no, I want to find out more about the backyard. So did you have a character in mind at that point? Were you just like?
I mean, it's funny, like, looking back on it now. It was like, I was in a like faction, and it was Graham. It was what was his name in it? I can't even remember. But it was GT and Ice. So GT and Ice, and I was Ice. And I came out in these, like, I bought them off eBay, these, like, pleather baggy trousers with, like, the white, black with white flames coming up them, and a wee crop top, and my hair, and, like, a full hawk and stuff like that. Tapes like this, because I thought it was, like, CM Punk. No, it was, like, I didn't really, like, see at the time, I was just happy to be in a wrestling ring. And, like, putting on little shows for my family and stuff like that and just having fun. Mm-hmm. And I didn't really think anything of it then. And then when I started training with Machine, and I realised, oh, wow, like, there's so many people here that I didn't realise. And it was through Machine and things like that I started, like, he says, like, Fergal Devitt's coming home from Japan. He's going to do a seminar. And I'm like, okay, I'm there. But before that, it was literally just like, I mean, you can look it up, like, Banger Championship Wrestling. I'm pretty sure there's probably still, like, a highlight video somewhere on YouTube where I'm coming out and I've got, like, the net, like, the tights on my arms and these pleather trousers or whatever, and doing some silly stuff, like, thinking, I'm so hardcore! No, it was, like, I mean, it was good for years, but it was, like, compared to that, to what I'm doing now. So we all start somewhere. And then what I've learned over the last 14 odd years has been crazy. And, like, me now and me then, it's completely different. I went through such a character change over the years. Like, Kasey, when she first started, was this cute little, like, wrestler. Like, I'm going to wrestle. I'm going to show that girls can wrestle. And now I'm, like, a demon. So what happened there?
So we're not going to see Ice anytime soon in the ring. It's, no. Oh,
well. No.
But no, we talk about that. That seems to be kind of, you don't see that as often now in female wrestling, especially, that everyone seems to have a character, and it's not all, because there was a time where it was all, I'm girl, I can wrestle too, kind of thing. And now you see the evolution of women's wrestling in this country and everywhere else, where it's now just, it's just wrestling, because everyone's got a character, everyone can wrestle each other, and it's not a case of I mean, there's some that play off it very well, that they're the girly girl kind of thing, but it's quite cool nowadays that the scope is there for, we can have a demon like yourself, we can have Molly being the big powerful, like, bitch, like, kind of thing as well, big,
you've powerhouse, got, you've got kind of thing, so. The comedian Canadian, you've got Emerson Jane, who's the workhorse, you've got Jetta and Charlie Morgan, like the Royal Aces, you've got Alex Windsor, you've got so many people out there that are just unreal. Like, my favourite people to watch right now, Rio, Leslie Evo, and when she was about before her other knee went out, was Alex Windsor. Like, love all three of them. And Alex Windsor is the only one to this day I've not wrestled in a singles match. I've never had the chance. Like, anytime it's ever been booked, something has happened to one of us. It's like the fates don't want it to happen.
The world's not ready for it.
It's not ready for it. So, Alex, please come back.
Speaking of Rio, then, of course, she's now a vital sensation. Thanks to your She-Wolf's partner, Molly, by launching her off, slightly pushing her off a balcony.
Oh, you know? the big girl and the other girl?
Oh, yeah. Is that the Jim Cornette quote?
No, that's the Al Snow quote.
Oh, of course, Al Snow. Anytime I see Al Snow, it always reminds me of that shoot interview going by Al. Someone asked him a question saying, by Al Snow's remit, if you draw money, you're a great wrestler. By that remit, are you a terrible wrestler? And it just always sticks in my mind because it's such a burn to read. Anyway. Let's speak about good stuff. And yeah, so when you saw that, and you saw the amount of comments and views it was getting, was it just how did you feel about seeing that and seeing the discourse that folk were saying about women's wrestling at that point?
Well, whenever I was literally at the entranceway, because later on in the match I get thrown out as like a distraction by the manifesto. So I'm literally sitting watching this, and I'm like, I'd walked through it with them earlier on in the day, and I looked at it and I'm like, that's a bit close. That's a bit close. And I'm like, everything's with you, Rio, for this. Like God help you. Like, and like, God love her, she did it. And like, fair play to her. Like, even for me, the one that likes to do crazy shit, like, even I went, okay. And when she went, and Barry was just there to catch her. Like, I freaked out backstage. Like, I knew it was coming. And I was like, oh, she's dead. She's dead. She's hurt. She's dead. Oh, God. Oh, God. And then the ref went out, checked, and came back. It's like, she'll be okay. She'll be okay. I'm like, she better be. But seeing what happens, like, I mean, I don't want to say, like, hypocritical or anything like that. Like, boys do it. Mm-hmm. All the guys do. Like, I think Rio's the first woman, and I'm going to say woman because she's not a girl, she's not a little girl, she's a grown woman, she knows what she's doing, she knows exactly what she's needing to do and what she's putting herself through. Is like, I want to say there's been about 12 or 13 people that have come off that balcony or been thrown off that balcony, and the first time a girl does it, it goes mental. Like, why? I mean, to be fair, the first person that came off that balcony bleeding, like, to the end of days was BT, and they got cancelled off my channel for that because it was too gory, because they went blood coming out of head. But that was the only other time that I've known, like, something gaining so much traction to the point where it's went, holy shit, like, what the hell's going on, and brought eyes to ICW. Because people wanted, whenever he did it, was like, okay, what have we missed? Like, what do we need to see? And then ICW like went up with more and more people getting involved, wanting to see the crazy shit that goes on in this company. That's the crazy shit we do in this company. Like, why is it so different that Rio did it and Molly did it? And like, there's been so much stuff that happened in that company before. Like, why does that make a difference that it's a girl? Like, it's a woman that's doing it.
Yeah, like, I mean, I watched it on the live stream on Fight, and it was one of the few times I just watched it headphones in, and I just audibly went, fuck, as soon as it happened. And it's not because of it was two women. I was like, oh, I wish there was another person there, you know, because Eli Bulwark was very close. There could have been a split second, then Rio was not getting anyone there to break that fall.
Yeah, exactly.
So I was even
all I could see in my head when they were planning it was, she's got to bounce off those ropes. She's going to do a Matt Hardy off a ladder and hit that rope and bounce down. Yeah. That was the only way I could think of trying to make it safe in a way. But she just hit that. She just hit the edge of the ring. Just hit the ring apron. I was like, oh God, man. But she was like, just, they're all battered and bruised after it. But it was a hell of a match.
Mm-hmm.
Go on, girlies. You did it. I'm proud of them. And like, Rio, since day one, like, I'm going back years here. I'm going back a fair few years. We had a like training seminar sort of thing down at British Empire Wrestling. And she was one of the girls that stood out to me. And like, we were walking back to go get food afterwards, after the show and after that day. And Rio and I just stuck beside each other, and she was asking me all these questions. She was asking for advice. And like, from that day, I was just like, you've got it. Like, you've got it up here. You know, like, you're going to be good. And whenever we had our match at the Fear and Loathing, was it 2019? I want to say 2020. I think it's 2020. Was it? Whatever year it was. It was recently anyway. My brain's like, dates and things like that are confusing with me. And when it was Rio's debut for ICW, and we had that match, and we both came back, and everybody was like, holy fuck, man. Like, yous went out and yous tore it down. It was like, that's the first time you wrestled, mate. And that's just, it just shows me, it doesn't matter how long you've been in this business. If you've been in this business like a couple of years or 10 or 14 years, if you've got it, you've got it. And Rio has it. And I can see, I can honestly see Rio like hit the sky and going for it. Like, she deserves to be seen on a bigger platform.
Absolutely. I mean, for my money, that was the match of the whole night. That match, mainly because of the fear of one of them maybe not coming out of it alive. But it was just the fact that it continued, and it was tables and all that afterwards, and you're still getting battered and all. It's
wild. Old school ICW. It was old school ICW. There were shenanigans, there was run-ins, there was distractions, there was tables, there was off balconies. It was what ICW was pre-WWE contract. It was exactly what we were. It reminds me of the main event match that Kaylee and I had. It was a great match, but we also had chairs, we had run-ins, we had like distractions, we had like ref pulls, everything. It was just shenanigan central, and that was what ICW was built on. People didn't know what was going to happen, like, and that's what people loved about it. So why not do that from now on?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yeah. So we'll get back to yourself though. So you mentioned ICW. I've got your debut down here is like 2012 for ICW. Before that though, I've got notes just saying Kasey. So of course this was 2011. I've got noted down here your first run in or team or just going with Kasey. Of course, people may know her better as Session Moss Martina. Was she another one that when you met was you kind of knew there was something?
I kind of
knew.
It was that way where at that stage, I was like, I don't want to say I was seen as the more experienced girl in Ireland, but I was only around maybe 6 months, 9 months earlier than Kasey came out. So it was just that way where it was like, right, Kelly, you need to lead this, you need to do this. And Kasey has come with me with all these ideas and boom, boom, boom. And I was like, you're a student in the game as well. Like, yeah, you're going to be good. And like, Kasey went through the same thing as me. Like, she needed to find who she was, what type of wrestler she was going to be, and she has. And she has blossomed, like, unbelievably to one of the biggest names in this industry. Not just in the UK, in the world. Like, everybody knows who Session Moss Martina is. And, like, I love that girl. Like, we've had our eyes and lows. I've had my wee green gremlin on the shoulder, wee green-eyed gremlin, because of a wee bit of jealousy and things like that. And I can admit that now. But like, I'm just happy to see people flourishing and doing well, and that's what's keeping me going at the minute over the last 6 weeks or so with this thing.
Yeah.
Watching all my friends do so well. I mean, seeing Kaylee and Isla Dawn getting called up to SmackDown, seeing JD Madonna called up to SmackDown, like, it's like, holy shit! Like, what's going on? Oh, sorry, called up to Raw. He was, but it's just like all these people that I've wrestled or I've trained with or I've known for years, reaping the rewards. So I'm like, oh, I was like, please, can I join these guys? Hi, I'm still here.
that's the coolest thing though. I mean, yeah, for 6 weeks, if you're not able to actually be to play, I suppose is a terrible way to put it, but yeah, you're not able to be part of it. It's seeing everyone else succeed. I mean, when Kaylee Ray versus Alba Fire, to those that are unaware, that she's going by now. I've got a picture with her from 2013. It was my first WrestleZone show up here, and it was her, Stevie, and Bingo Balance was the three I met at that show. And to go back through these pictures and seeing I saw Kaylee then, and now she's on SmackDown. It's amazing. Speaking of the Irish scene, though, what was it like when you started there? Because, of course, what I'm thinking then, 2009, I get words about myself.
Yeah.
Would have been like Sheamus, Finlay, and who else in the US?
That was even before me. That was like Irish Weapon, things like that.
Yeah.
Whenever I was going down, it was very much NLW. Like No Limits Wrestling and Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, which was Fergal Devitt and Paul Tracy's training school. So that's where we did the training weekends, should I say, with Fergal and or Finn Balor, as people may know more. And it was like, even then, like the talent pool there was unreal. One of my favorite wrestlers from Ireland who has retired now, boo, is Paddy Morrow. Like, he is unreal. Like, this is the way he sells, the way he moves, his psychology. Oh wow, like I could watch him all day. Like, he is amazing. Like, he was one of the more underrated guys, which I think should have been seen everywhere. there's a video from one of their tours that they did. It was American Wrestling Rampage, and it was actually it was Joker Bray's old company. I don't know if they'll still run that, I'm not sure. I do this, I kind of run off on a wee tangent.
That's fine.
And there's actually, they were on a tour in France, I think. They were going all around in Europe. And they had Marty Jannetty on it. So, right. Sean Maxer and Paddy Morrow reenact the barbershop to the point where Maxer super kicks Paddy. Paddy takes the bump in a hotel room. I have to remind you about this. In a hotel room. And then Sean lifts him up and throws him towards the window. Paddy goes, oh, no, I'm not just going to do what Sean did. What Marty did. He actually launched himself out of his window, out under the grass outside. And bus driver was sitting having a smoke outside going, the hell's going on? And Paddy's like, I'm fine, it's okay. Luckily, this is on the first, like, on the ground floor.
Yeah.
You can imagine him doing that out of a window on a balcony, but I mean, he still would. But Paddy, like, if you've got a chance to see, like, lads from the flats and, like, OTT or anything like that, and Paddy's with them, watch it. You'll understand why. He's just a fun guy to watch.
Amazing. When it comes to OTT, like my only kind of exposure to OTT is when it shows with Emerson Jane on, because I'm a massive fan of Emerson. So seeing her matches, and I'm like, okay, I'll watch a little bit more OTT, and seeing the names that they have coming over, it's just insane.
Yeah.
Like, they've had like John Moxley recently and Pac and all that kind of guys.
Yeah.
And it's definitely one up there as one of the more, in Europe anyway, one of the biggest promotions, I would hazard a guess anyway.
Definitely.
So ICW then. So 2012, it was the Arches, I think. Was it the Arches?
It was
Fierce Females, and then they did the tram, was it the tram spotting in a merge show? So ICW at that point, 2012, they were just about or were kicked off my channel for being too violent.
Yeah.
As you noted, it's because of BT Gun. What was it like getting to wrestling? Because their crowds were always like ravenous for wrestling. What was it like getting into ICW and seeing what the kind of hype was
Well,
about.
That's the thing, like, whenever me and Leah debuted for Fierce Females, we were like, oh, this is going to be fun. And then we debuted and we had our match with April Davids, and her name has just escaped me.
Lisa Fury, I think
Lisa
it was.
Lisa Fury. And then I realised, oh, wow, this crowd is insane. Like, literally, that's what it is. And like, that's what kept us coming back. Like, me and Leah, we would come back every month for ICW to be there, to be seen. It's like, hello, Dallas, we're here again. We'd really like to work with you. So it kind of worked in our favor. And it was so easy then to get sucked up into the hype train that was ICW. No, that is ICW, should I say. Because they were coming up and up and up and up and up, and it was just the wheels were rolling, and you better get on this train or you're going to get left behind. And we're like, I'm going to be on this train, so I'm moving. First of all, I'm going to Japan, then I'm moving. So yeah,
that's an next bit I've noticed. I've got noted, of course, is Ice Ribbon. Before I get to that, though, of course, teaming with your sister, with Lee, as there wasn't that many acts like yourself. There was the Blossom Twins as well, but yeah, generally the Owens Twins were pretty big because of that whole thing. Twins.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was before or after Bella Twins, because my timeline for things is awful as well, so yeah, I can't remember. But what was it like, were you wrestling first before your sister got involved? What was the timeline there for getting the Owens Twins together?
So I was wrestling, I was training with Machine for about a year or so before Leah got involved in training, because it was actually Machine said, like, I've heard you've got a twin. And I was like, yeah. And he was like, would she like to wrestle as well? Because that's money. Like you could go places with this. And I was like, I don't know, I'll ask her. So like, it was always been like, I was more the wrestling fan than Lee, were towards the point where I wanted to wrestle. Lee was just happy to watch. Mm-hmm. And then she came to training one day and took her first bump and was like, okay, this might be something. And then she started coming down to shows with me, and like, we would go down like every month. Like we basically, I was a driver at the time, because you know, you gotta work up that ladder. And I was the driver for Machine and Corbin and Tucker and I think that was it, really. Oh, or Duncan Disorderly, for a lot of shows. So Lee would tag along, and we would do merch, and we would watch the matches, and like, just take in what we could, and like, would always have our gear with us just in case. And a few times it came in handy. So so Leah came along about a year or so later, and we just kind of went on from there.
And of course, you auditioned for things like TNA British Bootcamp as well. I remember watching it at the time.
Our first actual tag match, with you saying about the Blossoms, the first time we actually tagged was for Pro Wrestling Eve versus the Blossoms.
Right.
And Dan Reed said to us when we arrived that day, you know, it's really hard to find footage of you tagging. It's like, because we've never tagged. And he's like, what? Like, no, we've never tagged. It's always been me with Leah as manager at ringside, or valet at ringside, where I wrestled Rachel or Kaza. We never did in regards tags. So that was a big, he was like, oh, wow. And thank God for Dan, because that match of the Blossoms, it was all right. But he says, like, I gave you another chance after that, because I didn't think I would bring you back. Because it was like, we weren't at that level for Eve. Because Eve has always had a level that you needed to be at to be worth bringing in, or to get in, like, bums and seats and that sort of thing. So me and Lee really, like, worked on it, like, to make sure that we would not be overlooked.
But no, it was amazing seeing Blossom Twins as well, because it's just a cool thing that you don't get too often. And the fact that that was your first
twin versus twin match as well, I think it was the first and only ever.
The history maker, then. You're a couple of years in, you're already making history. So speaking of history, then, Ice Ribbon is next in my timeline. I've literally just written down the years next to it. That's how my notes have worked for so I don't forget.
You've done your homework.
I've learned very quickly, because this is episode 203. I think the first 30 I didn't do any research. I just relied on my own brain, and by episode 30 I realized that's not
I need to write that stuff down.
I need to write stuff down. So Ice Ribbon, I was going through, I'm not very familiar with Japanese wrestling, so this is very much a dodgy ground for me to go on, because I'll look blank for quite a lot of it. But how did that come about? So 2013, went over to Ice Ribbon.
Well, at the time, that was a very, very tough year for me personally, and there was a lot of changes going on in my life at the time, and I just was like, I need to go, I need to get away somewhere. So I spoke to Fergal about it, like, do you know anybody? Or I was like, I really want to get out of Japan, I really, really love to go for like a few months, like, just to restart my life, sort of thing. And he got in contact with Kenny Omega, who got in contact with Shida for me, and then through them I was able to get a set of dates, which was the July to the end of the September, come on out, see what you can do. and she'll meet you at the airport and we'll sort you out somewhere to live and we'll train in and shows and all the rest of it. And I was like, okay, bye. And I went. It was literally, I started talking to them, I think in the January of that year of 2013. And then I was like, right, okay, I'll see you in June. And luckily enough, my work at the time, I was working at McDonald's still. And they were like, yeah, okay, that's fine. Like, your job will still be here when you come back. And I was like, great, thank you. And I went out there and Sheena met me. And then Kenny came out the next day because DDT used the same dojo to train at. So they were training with us. And that was really, really fun. And went out for dinner and stuff like that. He was like, right, kid, like, go off and do it. And I was like, okay, Kenny. It was really scary. It's the first time I've been away from my family this far away ever. And the first couple of weeks, it was like a big shock to the system. Culturally, training, like, just getting used to everything, doing everything myself, like, without Leah there. Because being a twin, you always have somebody there. But she wasn't there. She was like 9 hours behind. And I really found myself when I was there. And it was just, I wish I'd done more when I look back on it. But when you're wrestling 12, 13, 14, 15 year olds and you're 23, it's kind of, it takes you out of the comfort zone a little bit. Because Scooshy, she turned 16 in the September when Leah had come out. It was her birthday then. Kurumi, I think she was 15 as well. Kyuri, she was about 13, 14. And these are the girls that lived in the apartment with me at weekends. Whereas throughout the week, obviously, they have school and things like that. So it was just that weird way that at weekends, it was show. And then the rest of the week, training or go sightseeing or whatever, or do what you need to do. I was like, I love that place. I love Ice Ribbon for, like, I wasn't just Ice Ribbon. They managed to get me bookings with Reina, JWP, and a few other things. So it was just like, wow. Like, I was on the same show as Kana, aka Asuka, way back when she was doing her clown makeup and stuff like that back then, and wrestling at Cork and Hall, and just seeing so much of Japan, because we went to a place called Minami Sanmiku. And that was a place that was devastated by the tsunami. So we went out there as a company to just bring some relief to the people of the seaside town that was just decimated. And it was great to do that for them. And it was really, really like eye-opening to see how people are surviving from that. And yeah, it was just crazy. Like, I went and seen a whole load of DDT shows. Whenever Leah came over, went and seen a new Japan show at Cork and Hall and big Japan shows. It was just like, this is my life. I want this to be my life. Like, can I just live here? Like, I didn't want to leave come the end of the 3 months.
So speaking of was Japanese wrestling always something that you were instilled to learn about through things like Fergal and what have you? Yeah. And it was Japanese culture, it was something that you were very interested in? Because I know there seems to be a lot of wrestlers I speak to through this that like things like anime and just definitely a lot of Japanese culture. Was that, again, another plus point for trying to get over there?
Oh, yeah, 100%. Because it's like, Japan, like, I know it's another country, but it's like another world compared to here. Like, the way they live, the respect that they have for each other and themselves, it's just amazing. Like, I can't explain it. You need to, like, visit Japan at least once in your life, because it's just amazing. Like, I love the place. I love the people. I love, like, just everything.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those that if unlimited funds, I still haven't been to America, and that's another place I want to try and get to at some point in the future. Mm-hmm. You know, WrestleMania, that's your dream. Well, Royal Rumble, but WrestleMania is the one you want to go over for. So after that, I've got no. Sheeta was the name I know, because it was the one I was reading through going, I recognize that name. At least I've got something. I know that now. So of course, Sheeta being one of your contacts in Japan, so now seeing what she's up to in AEW and former women's champion, I think, in there as well. So
it's just crazy.
It's so cool going through, like I said, going through this list of cage match things, like accolades and places that you've been. It's just amazing. It's just amazing to read. Just going through, going, oh my god, you wrestled wrestled Kasey before she was Session Moth. You wrestled well, I've got Melina noted coming up soon in my notes here. So, and Soraya Knight, which is it was in 2014. So that was kind of the one.
Soraya Knight, Mercedes Martinez, Emi Sakura. Like I wrestled Emi Sakura on two occasions. One occasion in 2012, and that was before I went to Japan. And I was very, like, I learned so much out in Japan. Like, when I wrestled Emi the first time, it was like a Queen of the Ring for Eve before a Southside show and that sort of thing. And it was just that way. She had so many matches. And I was her first match of the night. And it was literally, I just got beat. I just got chopped within an inch of my life for this entire match. And I remember I hit her with a haluva kick in the corner and she just took it. And I was like, I've just killed her. I've just killed Emi Sakura. Oh shit. But then she hit me with like her moonsault and like her big stomp from the top and stuff like that afterwards. But and then I was very, very happy that a few years later, like, I got the chance to wrestle her again for Pro Eve. And like, even getting her feedback after that match, she was like, you know, so good. I was like, ah, my god, my god, I've learned something in the last 5 years.
So Soraya was the one that kind of you had, and then we had our email interview for the website way back when. So that was kind of just fresh off that match with Sweet Soraya. So that's another huge name that you wanted to take off as an opponent. Yeah. And so what was that kind of like? Was it, well, at this point you're what, 4 years in? Are you still nervous going into matches? Is it just...
Yeah, or... I mean, there's always an aura of fear when you're going into a match with Soraya Knight, because you just don't know what's going to happen. Yeah. You just don't. Like, and that day, like, we had an idea what we wanted to do, but she's just like, I'll see you out there, kid. And I'm like, no. I have to work on the fly. I'm not good at this. And, that was a trial by fire, that one. And I learned a lot in that match as well. And like, I do have a lot of respect for that, like, for her doing that, because it takes a lot of trust in the other person to listen whenever when you call stuff. And especially with me, like, half the time I'm going, what, can you repeat that? Like, I've been here, what? Like, you learn to listen very fast. So that was a big one. That was a big one.
Mm-hmm. And then after that, I've got like, this is the most organized I've been for timeline in episodes. So very happy with this so far. 2016 is where I've got my next kind of notes, of Stardom. And again, looking at the people that you were in the ring with, just unbelievable. Chelsea Green, Chris Wolf, Io Shirai, who's now Io Sky. Holy Dead, Thunder Rosa. What was like touring with Stardom?
Like, oh my god, I would love to work for Stardom again. But they want us as the twins, and Lee is retired, so I don't know if they'll take me as a demon, but I mean, you never know. it was just, see the amount of talent in that apartment. Like, we had Santana Garrett, Chelsea Green, like you said, Thunder Rosa, Holly Dead, just in that apartment alone. And then, like you said, Chris Wolf, Io Shirai, Mayu Iwatani, Kari Ojo. Like, you've so many out there, like even like Starlight Kid and things like that. Like, when they were just coming up, like, brand new, I'm watching them then, like, wow. Like, training with them on a daily basis at the dojo that 01 used. And it was just, it was crazy. Like, the first match that Lee and I had in that tag tournament was a time limit draw with Thunder Rock, which was Mayu and Io. And for them to put that much trust in us to go a time limit draw with two of their biggest names, I was like, oh wow, like, they see something in us here, so we better go out here and do this.
So I'm just loving hearing your passion for wrestling, because at this point, what, you're 13 years in and you're still just enjoying wrestling, which is always good, because,
like, there was a time I did like I'll be very honest, like, I did fall out of love with it. Like, there was a time before the whole thing with Stardom where I was just like, nothing was really going, I wasn't really getting that many bookings, and I was just like, what have I got to do to stand out here? Like, what do I have to do? And I was trying to come out more as a singles wrestler, so I was trying to work on myself, but people just wanted to book us as a tag team, and I was like, please, I need to branch out, I need to do things myself. And I was at a very low point, and like, again, if it wasn't for BT, he was just like, things take time, just let it happen, keep doing what you're doing, and it will happen. And from 2016 onwards, it just seems to have went straight up, and I was like, wow, okay, I'm gonna listen to you more often.
It's one of those things though, because like you're saying, I mean, Leah was kind of brought in as do you want to do some wrestling? Okay, yeah, I'll do some wrestling. So yeah, you're kind of, if folk are just wanting to book the Owens twins, like, Leah's not saying that she's not fussed, but she's like, I'm not she's not there to kind of make a career.
Fun. Yeah. I was there to make a career. Like, if you watch back the TNA boot camp, whenever we did our like their little introduction in the ring at Your Call, and Al Snow actually asked, so you're here as a team, but what would happen if we took one of you? And I couldn't hear what they were saying, to be perfectly honest. I could not hear a word they were saying, but Lee heard. And she says, take her, take Kasey, because she's the one that wants it. I'm here to help her get to where she needs to go. Mm-hmm. And to this day, I'm like, you little bitch. You made me cry in front of Gil Kemp and Samoa Joe and Al Snow. But yeah, like, Leah, like, if she got the chance to do things, she would go and do it. Mm-hmm. But it was that way. She's like, you really want this, Kelly. You really want this. Like, you're doing everything you can to get seen, to get noticed. You're talking to the right people. You've had tryouts, blah, blah, blah. Like, go. Like, I want you to make it. And I'm like, wow. Okay, thanks, sis.
And of course, you've had your battles yourselves between the two. You're not just as a team. I think one that springs to mind is, of course, it was a WTL title versus face match.
Yeah. You can't wrestle with my face. Like, wow. Oh, that was an interesting gimmick.
but I only remember that because I think a couple of weeks later, the W3L would do a tour up here because I'm in Elgin. So yeah, they usually do a North tour. And I met Leah, but of course she was in the mask. So it was just a very like, odd experience going, I've got like Fierce Females and nice WDVDs. And like, I've seen you wrestle, but just weird to see you in a mask.
Yeah, it's like, why is a mask? Like, because here I'm not allowed to show my face because it's Kelly's face.
So next one, I've already mentioned Melina, first match Southside. So as, mm-hmm. as far as like you've wrestled all these kind of legends and soon to be legends in Japan and the UK, but Melina, as far as I could see your matches here, it was your first like quote unquote import, was your first like US kind of opponent, if I'm right in thinking that. So that's someone who would have been about when you started watching, or at least when you were still watching. So yeah, what was that like?
I mean, it was an interesting like dynamic, because it was like she was so up for doing everything that I wanted to do, and I was just like, yeah, but I'm very happy to do your match. Like, I'm very happy to take all your moves. Like it's totally fine. But it was to find somebody who was so open to working with somebody, like, because you do get some imports where they're just like, I'm too tired, like, I just want to do my own thing. And you're like, that's fine, I'm here to put you over, it's fine. Where she was just like, yeah, what do you want to do? Oh, we can do this. And, da, da, da. And she was so excited for it. And it was like, when it came to the match, it was so much fun. And I had Leah at ringside as well, so we had that dynamic there where we played off that as well. So yeah, she was a fun one.
It's definitely one of those folk that you see her character on TV, of course, and she's this kind of just super bitch. That was pretty much the Melina character. And then again, she was up in the Northeast, and I wasn't gonna get, I think it was the same show, there was like Rikishi was on the show as well and all that, so I thought, right, I'll get a picture of Rikishi. I think Shane Helms was on it as well. But it's fine, I see Melina, that's cool. But as soon as I saw her and seen how wide open she was, just like speaking to folk, I was like, you know what,
yeah,
I'll go get a wee picture of Melina as well. Why not? Yeah, while I'm here.
Exactly, and why not?
just one of those, it's definitely not the person you see on TV is that. And
yeah,
hearing that as well, that you kind of had the same experience. So she was just there to go, no, what do you want to do? Let's meet.
Yeah,
you're the one that's going to be here longer than I am, kind of thing. So that's always nice to hear. Wrestlers are nice.
Yeah, it always is. Because you go in going, please don't be a dick, please don't be a dick, please don't, oh, you're really nice. It was like when I wrestled Lufisto, like, because of the aura Lufisto has, it's that way where it's like, please don't be a dick, because I really, really like you. And she was amazing. Like, she was so easy and fun to work with as well. So yeah, I've been lucky.
I mean, I don't want you to name names because we're not that kind of podcast, unless you want to. But has there been a wrestler that has had that where you're going, I'm so excited to meet this person, and if they've turned out to be just, yeah, a bit of a dick?
No, not
No?
that I can think of. No, because I haven't ever come away from a match going, fuck's sake, like they were hard to work, man. Like the whole day was difficult to work with because they were being difficult. Like, I think a lot of people know nowadays, like, you need to be humble on the way up as you are on the way down, because you have to remember when you're coming back down, you're going to be working the people coming up. So you need it, like, it's that way where it's just like, we're all here for the same thing, and that's to entertain people. Forget about what you're feeling or whatever. You're there to entertain the fans. Like, why make it hard on yourself? I'm there to have fun. Like, let's just have fun. It's wrestling. We play in spandex, like, for crying out loud. So come on.
No, it's like, yeah, we're most fans are going to be watching it. They don't care if there's any backstage beef or anything like that. They just want to see it
Yeah.
through, and
They
that's
want to
what
see a
they're
good
there
match.
for.
They want to see a good show. Exactly.
Absolutely. So you've done a lot of traveling then, of course. Then there's Japan and all that kind of stuff. I think I've seen you. I'm sure I've seen you wrestle once, or at least I've met you once. It was Dingwall, of all places, for Rock and
Oh,
Wrestle. So that
I
was,
don't wrestle.
oh, just that that what a place, Dingwall. There's
Oh, I know.
nothing, nothing
Oh.
there.
God love
But
Dingwall.
it's like traveling to all these places, and then obviously Dingwall, of all places. Is there anywhere that you've been able to get to that you didn't think you would manage, or even just places that you've been that you didn't expect to enjoy, I suppose. Like maybe you like Dingwall, but yeah, just odd little towns that you've been to going, oh, I never thought of I'd like this place or be to this place.
Like, if I get booked anywhere, I'm happy to work anywhere, really. And it's just that way where I didn't think I'd ever get booked in Germany. I got booked in Germany. Didn't think I'd ever work in France. I worked in France. And I see all the girls are all going out to Denmark. I'm like, you're next on my list. It's that way where it's just like, why not see the world? Like wrestling, it's hard sometimes because you're flown in, you're flown back out. You don't see much. And I was lucky enough at my last show, like, pre-Iron Girders, the week before, VT and I were in Prague for VCV wrestling, and it was the very first ever, again, history making women's singles match for in the Czech Republic. And we had 3 days. We arrived late on the Friday. We had the show on Saturday, and then we had a few hours to kill on Sunday. So we managed to go around and, like, do some sightseeing there. And I'm just like, this life isn't meant to be going, driving to gym hall and home, or flying in and out in the same day. If I can, I'm gonna try and get an extra day so I can see where I'm. Like I say, I've been here, I've been there, rather than here's another gym hall, here's another venue, that sort of thing. So it's just that way where I just want to work everywhere. Let's just work everywhere and have fun.
Was that before you had your before a BT turned to you and went, no, just it's a marathon, not a sprint, kind of thing. Is that when you kind of thought, right, I'm just gonna enjoy every moment that I have as a wrestler, just take it as it comes, and then or did you always
Literally,
have like a
it was
5 year
that way.
plan?
It was that way where I was so focused. Like, I have to be here at this time. I have to make this by then. And like, I need to be working for this person by this date, because if I don't do that, then I'm gonna. I was so like stressing out the fact that either I wasn't getting bookings, or I was getting, or I was missing bookings because of work or that sort of thing. And I'm just like, you know what? Work can work around me. Like, they know I've got another job. That this is my main job. That's just paying my bills at the minute until this can pay everything. So it was just that way where just enjoy it and don't put any pressure on yourself. Yes, nerves are great to have, because, like, I know it's cheesy to say, where it's like, because you care. Like, I have fun, but I also care and putting on a good show for people. Mm-hmm. Like, to this day, I still go, any feedback to everybody. Like, anybody who has watched the match, can I have some feedback, please? Or I'll give it to him to watch and go, feedback, please. because, like, yes, wrestling may not be a long-term thing for a lot of people. For me, it is. And I will wrestle until my body literally gives up. I can't see myself retiring really anytime soon, because there's so much more I still want to do and so much more fun I want to have with my friends and do so much more. Like, especially over the last couple of years, like Molly and Angel Hayes and Rio and Lizzie and I, we've all become really, really, really close. And the same with Emerson Jane and Debbie. And like, there's just so many girls that over the last few years we've all gotten so close. And it could have been just because of COVID making us all miss each other and realize actually we are a big family here. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to see everybody succeed, and we're going to help each other succeed by putting on the best matches that we can. So just have fun doing it.
I mean, nowadays as well, because I mean, around about this time, in our timeline here of 2016, 2017, is there was probably limited spots for women to wrestle on, especially mm-hmm. in like the UK. But nowadays it's there's multiple matches. There's intergender matches, if they want to call that, but it's just wrestling spots now, and now everyone's just like, no, get that bag kind of thing. They're just like, get on shows, just wrestle. And it's again, yeah, different from when my first exposure to Scottish wrestling was 2012. So I was kind of there just before the boom and what have you. So you hear stories of this poaching spots and all that kind of stuff, and nowadays you just don't hear that. It's a case of everyone, there's plenty of places now that you can get a match on the show. So it just sounds nice. It just sounds like a nice experience now in comparison to what it has. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're up to 2016, 2017, which is where you're kind of saying that's where everything just exploded and went up and up. And of course, that's when you became ICW Women's World Champion for the first time against Kaylee Ray. And as someone who was there, Fierce Females into the transition into ICW, what was that like, getting a hold of that belt, being the Women's World Champion, and just being all the world?
Full circle moment, shall we say. It was just that way where, oh, wow. it's deep in here. Like, it meant so much, because it was over. It was like from 2012, like, I wanted to work for ICW so badly. And if you look back at years previous to that, like, you look at Fear and Loathings and like Square Goals and things like that. Look, ringside. I'm ringside. I was doing ring crew. I was building cages. I was there from 6 o'clock in the morning to help set up, because I'm like, I'm doing this because I want to be there. I want to be there. And the year before, dare I say, the cage match, where I won it, was it the second time I won it, that one? The year before, I was ringside watching Kaylee, Carmel and Kim, or Viper, or Dewdrop, or whatever you want to call her these days, Viper, and watching them in their triple threat, and then Carmel cutting that promo where she retired. And I was like, oh, jeez. And then the next year, I'm in the cage. It was just like from winning that belt for the first time to that moment winning the belt, it was unreal. It was just all full circle moment. Like, just thank you, Kaylee. If it wasn't for Kaylee, Stevie, Xavier, BT, there wouldn't be the Kasey that you see today. Honestly. Like, there is another name to go in there, and that's Dan Reed for Pro Eve, because he really pushed me for this. He split Lee and I up and like really helped me like figure out who Kasey was. But with in-ring stuff and psychology, Kaylee, Stevie, and BT are the reasons how I work today.
It's like you saying that whole that year between you building the cage. I heard there was, like I said, I'm up in the Northeast, so I don't get see see the ICW shows live as often, or at all. Usually when they come up to Aberdeen, I'll see them. But there was a reputation, if there was a cage, there was going to be Kasey was there to be there building the cage.
Ratchets and stuff, yeah. So, I'll usually be on somebody's shoulders.
So
I'm very particular. It's like that's my baby, that's my ring. Like me and one of the other guys, like we timed how long it took for us to take the cage down at one of the shows, and we beat WWE. And we're like, yes, fucking did it.
Like I said, there's a logical brain in my head going there. Of course, you want a cage match because you know everything. You know that cage inside and out because you built it.
Yeah.
But no, speaking of opponents like that, then of course, Piper and Alba Fire, and you've had matches with things like Toni Storm and Nikki Cross, and
had Toni Storm's first match in the UK.
There you go, history making again. Yeah. That's just another one. So it's the fact
maybe that I'm everybody else's lucky charm.
that's the quote.
I'm everybody else's lucky charm.
If you ever stop being a demon, that's it, Kasey. Everyone's lucky charm. Just go lead into the stereotype. Why not? So another one. Next one I've got is 2018 against Gail Kim. I know this from. From going into this, I was seeing a lot of stuff from yourself and a lot of people speaking about this. This was a big, big match.
Oh, man.
For yourself.
whenever Ben came to me and said, like, you've done a lot of work for me and I want to show you that I do appreciate everything that you've done to put people over, like, Toni Storm and things like that on the shows and stuff. Like, Gail, between you and I, Gail's retiring next year. And I want you to be her final match in the UK. And I pretty much, my legs disappeared for me there whenever he told me that. Because, like, Gail is such, like, she was a trailblazer. She still is. She's an amazing producer. She is just, she put together the four-way match that we had for TNA boot camp. Like, she was just amazing. Like, she's so down to earth. Like the way that she thinks, the way that she sees certain things and how things should be put. Like, you can imagine me going to this match going, I know your entire moveset. Don't mark out while we're putting this match together. Da, 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 da. And then we're putting the match together and she's like, oh, we could do this. And like, I'm very aware that she's like, her back is wrecked. Like I can understand it now. My back's fucked. but back then it was like, I want to take care of you. But I still want to give you a really good match, even though I'm like, I always go, I'm just me. Like, I'm just me. I'm just Kasey. Like, I'm this girl from the UK. Like, and you've agreed to have this match for me. Whereas I'm doing it to try and give you the best match for your final match in the UK. And she was so amazing. Like, going in to that match, I felt like it was like, I made it at that point, where it was just like, people are trusting me to go in with people like these legends and have a good match. And like, there was a point in the match where I went, I've forgotten, I can't remember what I'm doing, I'm freaking out. And she was able just to take me and calm me down and go, look, remember, they don't know what's going on, just keep going, keep going, keep going. And I was like, all right, okay, wow. And I think from her I learned like a lot with regards to just relax. Just relax. Doesn't matter who I am or who you are or whatever, what's going on. Like, it's wrestling at the end of the day. Like, we all know how to do it. Just have fun. And it was just that continued on from there. And like, the funny thing was, when I lifted her up with my shoulders for her to go down the back for the roll up, I'm already crying because I know what's coming. And she's rolled me up, and she's like, even in the small package, it was just like, she was like, kick your legs, kick your legs, kick your legs. And I'm like, I'm trying. And then it was the 1, 2, 3. And I literally, like, she went on, she rolled one way, I rolled the other, and I just burst. I was just like, I've done it. I've had this match with one of my heroes. Like, this is never going to happen again. Like, with Gail. Like, this is it. And I'm like, I was like, I know it's cheesy to say, but I was just so honored to be. Like, thanks again, Ben. For like, he knows how much, like, I repost it every year on my Instagram. I repost it on the memories on Facebook and stuff, like, because it did mean so much. And like, to this day, she's still just the same amazing person. So thank you, Gail.
There's two things that came out of that I'm just amazed by. One, 8 years of all these opponents that you've had and titles that you've won, and that was when you thought you'd actually made it. It was 8 years in wrestling Gail Kim. It's like, is now everything from this point kind of just a bonus?
Oh yeah, like I could retire happily tomorrow. I'm not gonna, because I still have so much more I want to do. But it's just that way where it's like, if I can't wrestle Lita, I've Gail. I'm happy.
And the other thing was just that little bit of advice from Gail, which I've heard a couple other places, which is, we don't know. Like, the fans don't know if it's gone wrong. So as long as you don't panic
and make it obvious,
everything's fine.
Exactly. It's fine. And I say that to the other girls as well, because like, I'll come back and like, oh, fuck, I forgot that. But it's like, but everything went okay otherwise, so maybe it wasn't meant to be. Like, you can plan a million and one things, and you both of you will forget something, and you'll still move on to something else, and it'll still make sense. It'll never seem like with me and like going back, like with me and Rio at Eve, we had a time limit draw and then an extra 5 minutes. For the time limit, I remember Lauren saying to us, like, you're at 13 minutes. I was like, what? we planned too much because we were too scared, like, for not having enough.
Right.
And it was just that way. It was like, I always plan a little bit too much, but I'll have things that I can take out that I'll still make everything make sense. Mm-hmm. They're just there as filler. So if it's missed, it's fine. And that's what we did. And it's that way where nobody can tell or anything like that. But I've had where I've come backstage and I'm like, fuck, that would have been so cool. But it doesn't matter because the fans still loved it. Yeah. Or I've had girls come backstage or some guys come backstage at certain shows and be like, oh, fuck. Like, oh, he forgot this. They forgot that. And it's like, but did the fans care? Mm-hmm. Did you come back? Like, did everybody go, oh, that match was great. Whatever you've planned. Like, this is why I don't, like, I'll plan a long back end of my match. The rest of it I'll just have fun with, mm-hmm. because it's that way where it's like, oh, we can fill it in. We're wrestlers, we know what we're doing. And if you plan too much, then you're too focused. Like, you see it very much in younger girls or younger guys coming up. They'll plan everything, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, ABCD. And if they go ABC, forget D and go to F, and they're like, oh shit, oh no, everything's ruined. And you can see the panic and the stuttering and like, just go with it. Just go with it. It happens. You'll get there. But it's very easy for me to say that now after 14 years. Way back when, I would panic and be like, what's next? It happens. It's one of those learning curves you have to go through. And like, the more that you can relax into your role as what you're doing, the better your matches will become, because everything's more natural. It's naturally reacted to, naturally moved. It just seems a lot more fluid.
Perfect. So we've got next up is 2018 is World of Sport Wrestling.
Yep.
Yeah.
For that,
there we go.
Massive hair.
that was the oddest thing, because they're mentioning all these names and then they announced it all. But you were on the website, but they didn't announce you on their whole social media thing. It was the oddest thing to see, because you actually messaged us about it, because I was scrolling through the website because I'm a nerd. Scrolling through the website, I saw your name there. I was like, oh, cool, that's fine. That's someone that's like, I can plug it up. I put it up and you messaged us going, yeah, they haven't announced me yet. I'm like,
yeah.
Oh, no.
It's just in case you got trouble.
Yeah, but WOS, you made one televised appearance. I don't know if you made any. I don't know if any of the tour matches actually happened. I think some of them did, but WOS. Yeah. What was that like?
Well, that was a strange one. It was an odd day. Leah was meant to be in that match as well, but earlier on in the day, she coming down the ramp, she tweaked her knee. And because she's had ACL, like, she had issues with her ACL before, it was kind of like, uh-oh, like, does she continue with this? And she was taken out of medical reasons, so Leah wasn't in that match, so we had to quickly figure out what we were doing. And there was a lot of the same sort of spot happening in that match with different people. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that was fun. I was in with people that I love to work with. Like, again, Alba Fire, Piper Niven, Bea Priestley, and Aisha Raymond. And it was just that way. It was like, again, we're just going to have a bit of fun. I mean, the other girls had done a few matches before this, the days prior. So they were all a bit beat up, a bit sore. So when it came to this multi-person match, they were like, thank God, I don't have to do too much. So yeah, it was a fun, interesting day. And to watch the rest of the show getting filmed and everybody just having a good time, like seeing friends like Kirby and DJ Banks and like Big Ollie and stuff, like, oh, I should say Ollie Rampage and things like that at the show. It was nice to see.
It was so odd though. It was from again from our perspective, well, from my perspective, they just didn't know how to record wrestling. It was just odd. It was like Gladiators.
They did not. But if you were there live, you could appreciate it.
Oh yeah, but the way it went live on TV.
It was like they missed spots, they missed bumps, they missed things. I was like, did any of your producers ever watch wrestling? that was the only thing.
Oh, I was just furious. Looks like, again, going through this, you dodged 5-star wrestling. So there you go. Congratulations to you. but we've got NXT UK, though. So that's a pretty big one in comparison.
That's a massive one.
couple matches on actual NXT UK TV, or however it was done, streaming on the network, against names that, like, very recognizable names, like Ginny, Nia Samuels, and Chris Kayler, Alba Fire. So yeah, NXT UK. I remember seeing that your pictures when they used to put up pictures of the tryouts and seeing yourself on there. So was that just how it led? You got the tryout, they called you up, or what was the timeline there?
Well, I think it was a good year or two between, because I think it was 2017, maybe 2018 was the tryout, and then 2019 was the call up. 2017 tryouts, and funny enough, at the tryouts then, when it came for them for the extra to work a match with Asuka, it was Isla Dawn got it. It came down to me and Isla Dawn, and I was like, I'm just happy one of us is there. Obviously, Little Green Monster, I would love to have done it, but they obviously went with Isla. But I was just like, it was amazing to see her on the screen. I can't even remember the name they gave her, like Stephanie something.
Stacey Coates, if I remember rightly.
Stacey Coates, that's it. And yeah, it was good. And then I remember being in work, and it was the week before, like, TakeOver Blackpool. And I was in on the Friday, I think it was, previous. And I got the email. And I was like, oh! And I felt sick to my stomach, because I was like, my boss is going to kill me, but I don't care, because I know that I pre-warned them, like, so many times. If WWE come calling, bye. I'm not going to be here for those days that they need me. Bye. And she's like, right, okay, just get it sorted, and away you go. And that was fine. So I need to get my bloods checked within that week. I needed to get, there's a whole big rigmarole you have to go through to make sure that you can be on TV. So I got all that done, panicking, because I'm like, I need these results. Like, please give me my blood test results and blah, blah, blah. So I got there, and Jenny had actually messaged. I was actually, no, lies, it was Nina that messaged and says, I think it's us at Blackpool. And I was like, great, we work really well together. This has got to be great. And then, of course, things change on the day. And it was me and Jenny. And Jenny and I had never worked together before. Like, we'd been on shows together. So we knew how each other worked. We knew each other's movesets, kind of. So it was like, right, okay. And we had Brookside as our agent for the match. And we had, I think it was 6 minutes all in. So really, like, 3-4 minutes of work. And I was like, this is, like, see, even just trying to get my head around putting matches together like that, that then, like, helped me understand how to work cameras, how to work times, how to work this, how to work that. And I kind of treated it as a ICW show, because we had Alistair and we had Adam, which are two guys that film for ICW. And then I had Sean as my ref. I actually said to Sean when we got there that day, I was like, please tell me you're reffing my match. Please tell me you're reffing my match. And he was like, don't worry, I'll make sure. And lo and behold, he managed to wangle it so he could ref my match for me. So I was just like, I'm just treating this as a big ICW show. Just forget that Matt Bloom's back there and Shawn Michaels is back there and all these other people. And nah, don't freak out. And yeah, it was like, again, in that match, I had a wee bit of an oopsie, and we covered it. It was fine. Like, their camera work is amazing. Their editing is amazing. So you don't know it. Had a wee bit of an oopsie. happens, it's fine. But I remember sitting on the outside looking after the match had been done, just because you have to sell down low for Jenny to be on camera so she can, like, again, all the stuff that you learn doing these sort of things and then going backstage. And I remember going backstage and just bursting into tears because I was like, oh my God, I've screwed up in front of Shawn Michaels. Oh my God, I've screwed up in front of Brookside and in front of Saint, in front of Mossy, in front of all these people. Like, the night before, Triple H was there. Like, I was freaking out. And I was like, oh my God, I've screwed up. They're never going to want to hire me. Like, this is the death knell for me. They're never going to, blah, blah, blah. And the first person to see me backstage was Kaylee. And, like, I'm there in tears thinking about it now. Like, I love that girl, like, so much. She deserves everything that she gets in life because she works so hard on herself. But the amount of work that she's done to help girls like me coming up is unreal. Like, she is so selfless. When she just wants the best out of everybody, and she will push you, and she will push you. She will message you while she's sitting in Japan watching your matches back home and go, here's some feedback, why'd you do this? Like, she cares so much about this business, and like, I'm just so glad to call her a friend. So she was there backstage, and I'm glad that she was there because she gave me a big hug. Like, you didn't fuck up, you did a really good job. And the next thing I know, I feel this hand on my shoulder pulling me away from Kaylee. It was Brookside, and he marched me, like, I'm like this trying to hide my tears, marched me past Gorilla, past everybody, to what would have been Triple H's office the night before, and goes, why are you crying? I was like, because I care so much and I think I fucked up. And he was like, what was your job today? And I was like, to put Jenny over. I was like, yeah, to put Jenny over. And to be honest, that's one of the best matches Jenny has had in a long while. And I was like, you're just saying that to make me stop crying. And he was like, no. Your job was to put her over, and you put her over. So I'm happy with the match. So fucking be happy about the match. And just to cycle back to my tryout the year before, it was actually Brookside that sat me down after it all. Because I just literally, once it was all done and Regal gave his big speech and all like that afterwards, like, we had to hurry up and get out of the ring because it was SmackDown tapings were happening, and the actual workers, the actual employees needed in the ring to put their matches together. And I remember just turning and looking up the ramp to the Titantron, seeing all the, like, everybody's entrance videos playing and stuff like that, and just this one little tear. And Brookside came up and, like, took me aside and was like, this means a lot, doesn't it? And I was like, more than you know, because I'm like, at the time I was like, fuck, how old was it? Like, 29 at the time. And I'm like, mate, this, I never thought this would happen. And then for them to be called up to Blackpool, like, they see something in me, I need to make sure this is good. And because I put so much pressure on myself, I think it was just that way where I was like, after it all done, it was just that release. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh my God. And then they got in contact with me again for Bray Head, and I was like, okay, they must see something here. And then had a great match with Nina, and I had a better match with Kaylee, because again, and it was a nice it was a nice moment with Kaylee in the ring, because the ICW Mafia were in the arena as well, so you had ICW chants going as well in the middle of an NXT taping. And we did a boo-boo and kind of acknowledged the fact that people were chatting ICW when we shouldn't have, but you can't help it.
Yeah.
And then that was a fun match, and we were just like, it was just unreal. And then obviously the world went on fire and COVID happened.
That's it, yeah.
So after all that emotionalness, like, I think the world had enough.
that was it. It's like, did you have a match with Alex Windsor coming up that needed to be stopped? Yeah. Was that it?
Nah, I think so. I think that's what it was.
before the world went on fire, though, of course, the She-Wolves were really getting hot. There were, of course, yourself and Molly Spartan, playing TNT primarily, but there were... You're getting about as well as a team. We did have a chat with Molly about it way back when, a couple seasons ago, on the podcast. And but what was your kind of thoughts on just forming the She-Wolves and being the team?
Well, we were previously the Queen Bees in Future Shock for a year. And it was actually, I was debuting for TNT, and Wolfgang was booked as well as BT. So Molly came down with us. Molly was working merch, and Molly had this whole idea. Like, Molly is brilliant when it comes to, like, storytelling. Like, she doesn't go to a promotion and go, hi, I would like to work for your promotion. It was like, I would like to work for your promotion, and this is why. because I've got this 6 to 12 month plan that at the end of it, your women's division is going to be totally totally revived, totally like the whole renaissance will happen for you. And it was like, right, okay. So I remember it was a gauntlet match, and I was the final competitor for Lana Austin. Had the match, me and Lana Austin got a "This is awesome" chant, and we were just like, me and Lana Austin, like, when I talk about people that I just click with in the ring, she's one of those people. I mean, she's an amazing worker anyway, but she was one of those ones that when I had my first match with her, it was just boom, easy, done. And then it was that way where it was like, right, okay, so what can we do here? Because I think like our tag team would work here. So Molly did her usual thing, got thinking, got the wheels rolling. Got to speak of Jay. And the only thing that put Jay off was the fact that we were called Queen Beast. And it was obviously because that's Manchester. Mm-hmm. And we're in Liverpool. So it's like, how can we change this? And he's like, well, She Wolves. And initially I was like, yeah, why does that make me think of Shakira? So it's that way, you're like, no, it can be Shakira, but we're going to change it. We're going to make our own. Mm-hmm. And if it wasn't for Jay and TNT, like, I don't think the She-Wolves would have been as big a thing as we've become, as like an entity as we've become. I'm not saying like we're like on fucking, like, I'm trying to think of a faction like NAK level or anything like that, like UK factions, like, I know Lexi, started a bark there. But Jay basically gave us, like, we were very much involved in a lot of the storytelling and the story, like the writing of what we were doing. So I think that's what made us different compared to what happened before, because we were basically like bringing all comers to take on the She-Wolves, because we're going to come in as this dominant faction that's not afraid to do anything to get the win, and we want to showcase that fact. So bring in everybody, and then that means that we can showcase other girls that TNT might not have seen. And because, like, we could work tags or we could work singles, and like we had this whole story going with Lana and the whole story about the She-Wolves taking over the division. It doesn't matter if you're male, female, whatever, we're going to be taking over TNT. It kind of put the balls like in motion for everything that then came with regards to winning the tag titles. And look at the division now, look at TNT now. The size of that women's division is like I don't think any other division, like women's company in the UK besides an all women's promotion has a roster that they can pick from that size for their women's division. It's unreal, and I'm so glad that Jay like really pushes like the women to like show what we can do, like to rival the guys, and to allow, like, you got Alexis Falcon working with Charles Crowley, like their whole storyline, and that you had the Iron Woman matches, the multiple matches between Alexis Falcon and Lizzie, like working with Lizzie, working with Rio, working with Lana, working with all these women. And it's so good to see like it all coming up, having the very first ever women's death match in the UK, like tournament in the UK. And there was like, Jay was like, do you think girls would want to do it? It's like, I could think about 8 or 9 like offhand who've been wanting to do this stuff but never have the opportunity because they don't want to do women's like death matches. Like Alba and Piper, their death match at ICW, I think, was one of the most like talked about, because like it was very rarely seen. And then we had Total Carnage, and I pretty much nearly died. But I mean, it's death matches. Like, it's what happens. I mean, I nearly completed it. But yeah, so I'm really, really proud to like represent TNT in that way. And I'm really, really thankful for Jay for giving us that platform to do that as well.
So before I get to the, like, we've got some questions on Instagram as well. Just so it's just Ian Skinner, really, who's taking over the questions. But which just hurts my brain every time I read it out. But before we go to that, of course, you're current Discovery Wrestling Women's Champion as well. Discovery's a company I love to watch.
I love Discovery.
On YouTube. So. And you're able to bring the She-Wolves. I think that's outside of ICW. I think Discovery is the only other place at the moment where She-Wolves are really kind of a thing.
Yeah.
At the side of the border. So, what's your Discovery? have you enjoyed being in Discovery? But there's the question.
We got there. Yeah, like Disco is another place where Alan just knows what he wants, and like he has this vision for the future. It's not like right show by show. It's like, where do I want Discovery to be in the next 12 months? And how do we get to that point? And how do we get to our roster at that point? And how are these stories going to develop over that time? And I think that's what like stands them out compared to other companies, the same way that ICW did and does, is storylines and like you have your core fan base that are always going to be there. So why not give them something to get their teeth into, really? And we know that we can get a reaction for the She-Wolves, and we have our fans, we have our detractors, whatever. Like, that's what we're there for. We're meant to be a polarizing team. We're like, you either love us or you hate us. Like, so why not bring that in and use that fact?
Absolutely. So we've got a couple questions that we ask everyone, and they'll do the Instagram, and then we'll kind of wrap up and let you get on with the rest of your day. We ask everyone, what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
I didn't expect that question.
I know. You can blame Luke King Sharp and Krieger for this particular question.
Thanks, Krieger. Let's think. I mean, if a sheep can tip that cow, but it's about how they're going to do it. But one swift kick from a cow, I think the sheep are going to lose.
And the other left field question that we ask people is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Favorite dinosaur? is where I start naming them from Land Before Time.
That's fine. Okay, just go for it. Littlefoot.
Oh, that's it. Ducky. Ducky from Land Before Time.
There we go. That's fine. My love of dinosaurs is recently reignited because I watched Power Rangers Once and Always. Amazing. So Ian Skinner here. He has asked, first one, favorite movie monster. Quite a nice one.
Favorite movie monster?
Yeah.
Jason. From that's it, just Jason. But specifically when he was played by Kane, because he was my favorite Jason.
There you go. And the other one is, I hate this question, Ian, and you know it. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games and no games? Yep, that's about as I imagine the response to it. It's a stupid question.
So unlimited bacon and no games, or games. Unlimited games, no bacon?
It doesn't even say anything about bacon. It's just unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, so you have limited games but no games.
Okay, so games, because like I don't eat that much bacon. Like, bacon's nice, but I don't eat much.
There we go. Ian, thank you for absolutely ruining my podcast with that question every time. But no, we somehow covered all my bullet points here. I can't believe it. And we're not even an hour and a half in. So where can people find out more about
it? I mean, to be fair, I usually talk a lot longer.
I don't doubt that for a second, because I just enjoy it. I feel like I could probably just give you a couple bullet points and just let you just go with stories. So
pretty much.
Yeah. So where can people find out more about yourself? I know you've got OnlyFans as well. So just plug all your stuff that you can, especially while you're injured. How can people pay you?
So like, OnlyFans is pretty much brand new for me. It's been open since December. I closed my Patreon down because it was so much content based. I just didn't have the time to sort out the content that I wanted to, like match critiques and stuff like that. Like I would literally watch a match and like talk our way through it, like this and that and the other, like what I liked about the match, what I didn't like about the match, that sort of thing, or like gym tutorials or gym training and things like that, or wrestling training. I just didn't have the time. Once I started going back to work, I could do it all during lockdowns, but I couldn't do it during, so that closed down. So yeah, so Mother of Chaos 666 on OnlyFans, and I always forget my Twitter and my Instagram, but one of them's Kasey Owens 5, the other one's Kasey Owens 11. You'll find it there. Facebook, just Kasey Owens on that. See me there.
Kasey, I do Owens have some merch,
but it's very limited. I'm getting new merch made, so DM me and I'll let you know what I've got left.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me on this May Day, even though folk are going to see it 3 weeks later. But
Yeah,
thank you
and
for taking
hopefully
the
I don't have this anymore.
time. Fingers crossed, that's the hope, and you'll be back sooner rather than later. But again, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.